Good evening, everyone who has joined from India, and good afternoon and good morning to those who have joined from different parts of the world. This is in the series of webinar we are conducting through LASEB to create awareness on Lean and Six Sigma tools to the entire community. In the last webinar, we have covered value stream mapping, and you can view the recording of this webinar on LASEB.org webinar section under the download section. Today's webinar is on cancer subsampling. I am Varun Khare, and I will be your host for the entire session, and Mr. Nishant Khare, who is a lead consultant with Capgemini UK, will be the presenter for you. Now we want to say something about LASEB. What is LASEB all about? LASEB is Lean and Six Sigma International Board, a not-for-profit society in the area of Lean Six Sigma and business excellence. It is conceptualized in 2009 by top industry leaders and came into existence in 2010. And it registered in 2011. Why LASEB? Because Lean Six Sigma concepts are here to stay, to spread the awareness of Lean and Six Sigma concept and share learnings for community at large. LASEB has touched the lives of over 10,000 plus professionals from 40 plus countries. Now, before we move on to the presentation, we will take you through some of the basic ground rules. Total duration of the webinar will be of 45 minutes, and in which presentation time will be of 30 minutes. Question answer session will be of 15 minutes. You can post your question on the webinar chat box, which is on the right hand side of your screen. The video of this webinar will be available at the link provided to you on the screen. Link will also be mailed to you. Presentation for download is available only for our professional members and corporate members only. In case of any problem, please contact me. My name is Varun Khare, and you can contact me through my email ID, which is there on your screen. And if you want to know something about LASEB, if you want to associate with LASEB, you can directly contact me. Now, before we move on to the presentation, I just want to give a brief introduction of our presenter. Mr. Nishant Khare. Nishant Khare is a lead consultant with Capgemini UK. He is also a certified DMAG Six Sigma Black Belt and CA Clarity Function Consultant. Over 8 years of experience in process analysis, process definition and improvement for various global clients and internally for a major IT giant in India. He is also experienced practicing and mentoring process improvement project using Six Sigma Lean and statistic based tools. He is currently in UK. For the last 5 years, and handling improvement program for a major financial company, and before that he was in US working for a banking group. Without any further ado, I now hand over to Nishant to start the webinar. Nishant, over to you.
Thank you, Varun. I hope you can hear me, Varun.
Yes, I can hear you. You can start.
Thank you so much, Varun, and thank you everyone who has joined, and LASEB for giving me an opportunity to based on our experience to share some of the knowledge we have acquired over whatever experience we have it in this industry. Definitely there are few things which I would want to cover, but the entire presentation will run out in terms of telling you the concept and possibly taking that concept into your organization or wherever you are working, take it there and try and implement that. I'll be more focused on the concept rather than the actual details of what is sampling. So let's talk about it. So what is the concept? It's very straightforward. We do it day in day out. Wherever we go, we try to do sampling to make some inferences. So this is what we do it day in day out. So what do we try to do? So based on that sampling, we try to make some inferences. What does this concept lead to? This concept lead to the satisfaction of the end user, satisfaction of yourself, and basically this is to make sure that anything which has to do with sampling, you made the correct choice. What is the need? Definitely, because we cannot test the overall things in a given time we have, so we try and make judgments of the sample we have it. But what is sorry about that. So what is the most important thing this concept deliver? The concept delivers conformance to customer requirement, and I'm sure that you might be thinking about why this has so many questions, and then the end of the day we're talking about sampling at all. So let's see how this concept is going to help us. Always think of any Six Sigma or any lean concept or anything which you're trying to do, try and relate with home, anything which you do it. Can you think of some examples? Yes, we do have example which we don't have to go somewhere in the industry. We have seen it long time, like in our mother's kitchen. So let's try and see how these four questions relate to our mother kitchens. We have seen our mothers cooking for us day in day out. So what she does from the process point of view, she goes out to the market, she picks up the right things for cooking, she makes some inferences, and I'm sure a lot of people, all of us, we have also done that. If I remember my childhood days, if we want to go and pick up some rice, we used to see a little bit of rice, we used to take our little bit of rice in our hand, and then we try to make some judgment about those, the overall, and then we say, can you give me this much amount? So this is what the sampling is in concept. What does it give? By looking into the rice, it gives us the satisfaction that yes, I've made the correct choice. And what is the need? Because I don't have any, I don't have the time, the cost to go and cook and then test it and then talk about it, whether it's a correct rice for my home or not. This is exactly what a mother does. And she is a perfect example of a Lean Six Sigma in any sense, right from sampling to testing to making sure that it is confirmed to requirement, which is about feeding us. So let's move into the why part of it. Why there is a need? I've already touched about it, that it involves effort, time and cost. So ideally speaking, we don't have time these days, right? Everyone of us make a judgment of someone by just looking into some attribute and making an inference about it. So why do we need to do it right? Just to make sure that we make a correct inferences. Why there is a need to draw correct inferences? Basically to gain confidence, right? Whether I'm selecting whatever things I'm selecting based on sample is what I'm expected to get. Why there is a need to understand these concepts doesn't necessarily play a role in everyone's life, and to do it right first time is what everyone expect, right? I should not be repenting upon whatever I have done. So let's do it right first time. That's the way everyone understand. So what does this concept deliver? Cost effectiveness to remain in business. And now if we try and relate things of us home and to a business perspective, you will know that anything to do with cost is going to be making sure that you remain in business. the more and more the competition is building up, we are in a stringent situation wherein we have to cut down costs, and the best we can do is to make sure with less effort we make correct choices. We are talking about samples, but there are situations where we need not to also do sampling. If it was an interactive session, I would have asked this question and would have got some answers, but we should also think about, you're talking about saving cost, effort, time, but are there any situations where we need not to do any sampling? Yes, there are. For example, life-saving equipment, we cannot do a sampling to make judgment. It has to be 100% thoroughly checked for any of the life-saving equipment. For example, pacemakers, these are very, very critical to for anyone to survive, right? So that's the need of having no sampling done of on those equipment. You can talk about it, you can come up with more examples, but this is wherein I thought where we don't require any sampling to be done. So what is sampling? I'll try to show it with some graphical. Now, when we say population, the immediate thing which comes to our mind is the population of a country. And exactly, you're right, that when we say population, it is means the combination of people, the combination of resources, it could be material, it could be men, it could be anything. So this is the process. This is what you want to talk about, right? This is what you want to make judgment about, that with certain limited information, how do I judge something very big about population? So we try to do a sampling frame, and the frame, these terms will come little later in the presentation, but if you ideally look at the sampling frame, it's nothing but the places where we want to pick up the sample from. Then there's a sampling process involved, and for this, whenever you get confused, always try and relate with home. That's the best. I would always say that what your mother does, it's exactly the same. Think of going into the market, picking up vegetables, picking up anything, say daily groceries. She does it all the time, and you have also done it knowingly or unknowingly. You also make judgment about people by looking what just a small part of a person attribute. It could be the way he walks, the way she talk. This is all nothing but sampling. So if with the sampling process I divide the sample, and then this is what you actually observe in a data with the help of a sample, and then you try to make inferences about population. So this is a very simple concept, and this is how it has been defined, using data to say something or make inferences, judgment with a certain degree of confidence about the population, because the best way is to always go about testing everything what you have, and then you can make a perfect judgment about anything. But as I said, sampling does involve cost, effort, and time. So you can, any day-to-day life which you think we are always seeing, I know I don't want to talk about it, but in general, but you always see it happening around you, and especially for these years we are seeing it many exit polls, right? This is one very good example wherein the sanity of sample, the way they select people, and somewhat they come out very close to the reality, right? How many seats one party is going to get, how many seats other party is going to get it. So that way, there are some questions and answers which I was planning to cover in detail, but let's see if I can make an attempt of explaining you what is exactly we're trying to convey here. So with all those concepts in mind, that what is sample, what is population, So this is how we want to generalize. What are the questions that what do you want to generalize to? Basically, I'm trying to make a judgment about a bigger thing. Okay, this is called as a theoretical problem population. And so what is the population you get access to? It's basically where you can approach. This is how I would put it across for a sample. This is called as steady population. How you can get access to them? Now, if you look at the real scenario, if I have to take an example of an exit poll, so these goes out and say, you know, I will go into a specific region where this community lives more, and I'll go out to another a community where this gender is more. So we get a mix of people from all the genders, all the age, all the community, so that we get a fair idea of what would be the reality. So this is nothing but a sampling frame. And then who's in a study? The people who are actually, or the material you're actually testing it, this is what we call it as a sample. One very important aspect, and I will spend a couple of minutes here on this example. I've talked about the population, I've talked about the sample, I've talked about sample frame. So let's see what is homogeneous and heterogeneous. Now, homogeneous is wherein people have or product have similar characteristics. Now, it's very simple that everyone is similar. There's no variation. There's very less population which are differentiating from one from the other. So that is what is called as homogeneous, which have identical or similar characteristics. And there's also called as heterogeneous, wherein different characteristics are there. But I'll first focus on homogeneous. And I put up a question. For example, if all the human on earth were homogeneous, like everyone was identical in characteristics, everyone was exactly similar, how many people would an alien, when I'm talking about the third word, which would need to update, basically trying to grab it and see how humans were like, how we can inference about humans. It's very simple. If there is a less variability, if there is less chances of putting up a variation, you would require minimum sample to infer about something. So my answer is that you only need a person from the whole population to infer about this entire word. This is how homogeneity helps in identifying and saving cost. So if I have to tie back to the Lean Six Sigma concept, wherein they talk about less variability, so if I have to try and link how sample size would you would determine based on how much variability is there in the your product or process, how much variation is there. So if you have a less variation and your process is more likely to deliver similar kind of attribute, you would need less number of people or sample to judge anything about the whole population. Now let's see how heterogeneous come into picture. And I have the same questions for heterogeneous. In case if the population is heterogeneous in nature, how would and many people would an alien need to abduct? Will it be 1, 2, 3? The answer is many, right? Because then we are talking about different countries, then we are talking about different characteristics. People from US are different than people from UK, people from India. Within India, you would find difference in characteristics of people. So you would need many sample to infer anything about population. So what are the moral of the story? The moral of the story is nothing but, you know, the less variability you have in your process, the more likely you would get to see a less number of sample being used to correctly infer about the population. So that's really the key takeaway from this example. I've talked about variable. Now I'll touch upon what are the terms which are being used for samples. So what is a variable? You take one sample, you read something, and the actual value you get is called variable. What is a statistic? Statistic is nothing but if you're trying to infer, for example, I've given an example of average height. So if I go about measuring a height of an individual, so what is the sample I measure one? It comes out to be, you know, 5'6". So what is the parameter? It's something called as known variable of a population. So if I have the liberty of going and measuring everyone's height in the world, this is what the parameter. So if I have to relate anything to with this slide, is that parameter is trying to make sure that we understand the properties of a population. Statistics is nothing but we are trying to understand the properties of a sample, and variable is nothing but when we are trying to make sure that anything which you are taking as a note or reading an outcome or a response is called variability. With this, I will come to what is the type of sampling we have. It there are non-statistical sampling, which talks about convenience, and we do it data, and most of us do it non-statistical sampling, and it's very easy, right? It's very quick. Convenience, let's see who is available. Judgmental, selecting what seems like, let's interview this guy because he seems to be knowledgeable enough. Snowball, I have interviewed you. Can you suggest somebody else's name to so that I can interview, or no? That way, this is called snowball. Purposive, selection based on purpose. I want to know what is the average size, shoe size of a woman. So I'm actually targeting only women's. Expert, I'll call the expert for their opinion or study. Quota sampling is like I keep on taking a sample until my sample quota is reachable. So there are many other things which you can talk about it in non-statistical sampling. Statistical, simple random sampling. If I have to tell you in simple terms, that when you pick up a card from a deck, is that every card has an equal chance of getting selected. So it could be ace, it could be two, it could be three. So this is called as random sampling. The random sampling is the best sampling way of sampling, doing it. And one good thing about random sampling is that you have to that homogeneous and heterogeneous is built within the process. When you say stratified random sampling, you are actually talking about grouping them, wherein, for example, a very simple example is, again, if I have to say spade, so I'm only limited to a 13 spade in a card, deck of card. So this has become heterogeneous. Systematic random sampling, like for example, I will select every fourth card. This is called systematic random sampling. Cluster is more likely to do with different geographies. For example, let's talk about anything to do with a global warming issue, for example. Now, if I have to go around the globe, I have to check which are the people which are getting more affected out of it. So, wherein we will select those areas where we want to talk about it, and then we'll select individual within those cluster. We will want to do it random. Multi-stage, then if at all we want to go into different geographies, I will then do another round of kind of a sampling, or make a sampling plan of going into a different race of people. Could be I'm talking to a different community, a different caste. So that is again called as a stratifying. And this is more complex in nature. So if at all I have to think of an example, again, exit pool comes into my mind of doing a multi-stage sampling. With all this thing, I have one example. I think all of people while looking into the example will laugh into it. But this tells us a very, very important aspect of sampling error. And this example says something that a king was having a two very good minister. One was a very intelligent guy, but he was very ugly. The other one was really good looking, but of average intelligence. One day he discovered that by some source that his wife is having an affair with one of them, but that source couldn't tell which one of the minister his wife is having an affair. So he thought that it can't be ugly, because ugly, how would my wife, she's a king after a king's wife, she will not go for an ugly one, she would definitely go for a good looking one. So what is actually king doing in making that sort of an assumption just based on some attributes of a guy? Let's see what the sampling error talks about. Let's not go into the detail. Let's say if I have to talk about an attribute for a complete population, and then I'm classifying it as being non-guilty and guilty. So if it is king is making a verdict based on just some attribute. Suppose this guy doesn't turn out to be the real guy, right? And he found it guilty. So he's making a kind of a type one error. So actually, if at all I have to look into these two ministers, the ugly one was the guilty, but he actually made an assumption based on sample that the good looking one is the guilty one. So this is nothing but type one error. And the same goes the other way. He could have said ugly one is not guilty, right? But the truth is that the ugly one is guilty. So he's also making an assumption which is also called as type two error. And the guilty one goes free. So that's where you have to understand that sample is not entirely the representation of a population. So there is some sort of error built in within the sample. You have to make sure that to what extent I can have that error and how it will affect me. So that's really all about sampling. But again, with all that concept, you would definitely ask me next question, how big is the sample? So there are many things which govern how big is the sample. The one biggest thing is cost, and the other biggest thing is variation. So if at all it's variation, less variation process, you would want to go with less number of sample. But if at all there is also a cost involved, so business might want to take a decision that no, we'll do it in one sample. There are statistics decisions like level of precision, size of the whole population, how much you want to do it, and what you're actually trying to investigate. For example, if I'm trying to make any assumption for the number of seats in Lok Sabha, so this is what my objective is. So I would want to do a sampling based on this objective. And obviously the last one is the variation. The more variation, more likely you want to get it, a bigger sample. So there's some formula which you can always look into the details by going to web. There are n number of materials available over the net, and LASIP also have a good collection of material. So I think I'm spot on with the time. Thank you very much for you guys attending the webinar, and thank you, Varun. Over to you.
Thanks, Nishant. Now I would like to thank our presenter for the informative presentation today. We will now start the question and answer session. Just as a reminder, if you have any comments or questions regarding the information shared in the presentation, you can contact Nishant anytime after the webinar. The first question is, The first question is, how I know what is the sample size for a particular population?
That's a very good question. If that's where I was saying that how big is the sample size, where you have to consider what is the objective you're trying to achieve with that population, right? And how much variability is present. So if I have to go only statistical, that formula gives you that statistical, but there are cases which where formula doesn't work. So the business decision and the cost variation supersede those things. So you have to be very clear on the objective you're trying to achieve with that sample. For example, in case if it's a death threatening situation, you wouldn't want to sample it, right? So that's how much error you want to allow based on the sample is what you got. Yep.
The second question is on your skin, Nishant.
I'll read out the question. A mineral water company wants to find out why people choose a particular brand of mineral water. Identify the sampling technique used. If a mail-in response card is attached to the neck of every bottle mineral water that company sells. I'm not entirely sure what we're trying to achieve here, but a mineral water company wants to find out why people choose a particular brand. This again, this is more to do with what you want to achieve, right? Your sales is what you're trying to say, that why my sales are slow. That could be of many factors. So definitely a purposive sampling is a kind of sampling which you are trying to achieve here, and that will let you know that what is the purpose of having this and how we are going to do it. So that's where this will help you to identify if this is the right choice for people or whether we are lacking somewhere. This is more to do with understanding of the population rather than just sampling, but that's a good question. Yeah.
Thank you, Nishant. This is all the question we have, and thank you very much all of you who have attended this webinar and gained an insight of what is sampling actually means. Thank you very much.